Hello, my name is Professor Darius Watson, and this is a material overview for the first 4 weeks of PS210, Ethical Controversies in Security and Intelligence. The general goal of this overview is to prepare students for the Week 4 component test. The specific goal of this overview is to make sure that students are ready for the component test in terms of assessing their understanding and ability to apply key concepts and theories presented through the first 4 weeks of materials. Please consider that this is a supplement to those materials, and students are expected to be fully responsible for all additional concepts or ideas covered in them that might not be specifically discussed in this particular presentation. The goal of the Week 1 readings is to have students develop, first, a clear understanding of the concepts of ethics and morals, and then an ability to begin discussing those concepts across differing frameworks of thought and consideration. Morals are a fundamental understanding or an application of right and wrong that guide individual perceptions of reality and specifically behavior. It's important to consider the idea that for all intents and purposes, morals are assumed. Morals are not typically something that are specifically considered within each instance of decision-making. They just are. Ethics are the manifestation of morals within individual and group codes of conduct. They are the actual specific or explicit frameworks, rules, laws, and norms that are both established and used to enforce appropriate behavior. It is important, I think, to consider the idea that both norms and, to a broader extent, morals and ethics vary according to context as well. So, from the beginning, one of the things that we're going to have to consider is the idea that there really is no single set of objectively true or valid ethics or morals. Consider the following. Individuals have morals and exhibit ethics. Groups can only exhibit ethics. The moral foundation of group ethics is a result of the collective understanding of right and wrong developed by the group. I think this is important when we consider things like the current atmosphere in American politics today. For better or for worse, I think a lot of observers tend to look at things like the government or business or even individual agencies and institutions as having morals and thus responsible for exhibiting a certain type of ethic. The reality is that the ethics we are looking for when we talk about the media or the Department of Justice or the FBI or even the Russian government is dependent upon what we understand the moral frameworks underlying those ethics to be. Long-term versus short-term solutions for ethical dilemmas, as Schaefer argues in the first reading, involve a trade-off between individual and group benefits. What's important for this argument, and it is just an argument, is that any time an individual is confronted by an ethical dilemma, they are also confronted by a dilemma regarding whether or not they should choose in favor of themselves or the group. Put another way, I think many people find it difficult sometimes to follow what they understand to be their own morals and codes of ethics, relative to, for instance, what might be required of them as a member of a church or a religion, as an employee at a certain business, or even as a student within a course or a university dynamic. It's the trade-off between these individual and group levels of ethical frameworks that often creates secondary, even tertiary levels of ethical dilemmas. It's not just the problem of doing right or wrong for a whistleblower. The problem is, what are the relative impacts of those of that whistleblowing for both them, their immediate coworkers, or even the business as a whole? And so the idea of considering ethical and moral decisions within only a single framework, I would argue, really hampers your ability to fully understand all of the variables that are at play, given a specific decision being made. Obviously, the goal is to move from a very general or philosophical understanding of ethics to a more practical ability to apply them. The way I think in terms of instruction is trying to lay down the building blocks first. I don't want you to try and build a house until you can tell me the difference between a brick and a board. In that regard, Once you do understand how those things fit one versus the other, we can then begin talking about how they get put together. From our perspective, what we begin looking at is the idea of ethics and politics. Whether it is from a cultural, national, individual, or organizational perspective, there simply is no such thing as a single objectively defined ethical framework for all. This is the foundation of the need to develop comparative understandings of decision-making frameworks across all of these dimensions. The simple truth is that if we're talking religion, or we're talking about evolutionism, or we're talking about the code of conduct at the university, or even the code of conduct at your place of employment, as important as these frameworks for ethical behavior are, it is virtually impossible to argue that they are applicable across all circumstances for all people. When we then extrapolate that to the state level, it becomes almost impossible to begin to identify deep, subjective ethical frameworks that we can then use to analyze decision-making. It's for these reasons that we engage the concepts of theory. Theory is really an attempt to kind of organize reality. And when it comes to ethics, there are a variety of different frameworks and theories and understandings that have played a role in developing our understandings of ethical frameworks. The most important in, I think, many ways and for many people are socio-religious heritages. One of the readings in the week one materials really focuses directly on the wide variety of what it identifies as heritages or legacies of social and religious traditions, teachings, morals, and principles that have come to develop ethical frameworks that then guide individual and ultimately societal decision making. I don't want to go through a whole bunch of discussion here, as I think the document itself does a good job differentiating the various heritages. What I would point out, however, is a theme that is going to be important to consider relative to your development of comparative politics and the skills that go with that methodology, is an understanding that if we look at all ethics and morals as inherently subjective and to a degree constructed, then we must then understand the enormous impact that Western tradition and heritages, and the Judeo-Christian tradition in particular, has had on the broader understandings of ethics and morals at the global level. It is important, for instance, when you're reviewing the various heritages discussed in the materials for the week one readings, that you understand the impact of Judeo-Christian models and ethics on, for instance, Middle Eastern, Asian, African, Latino, and even alternative frameworks of understanding, as all of them to one degree or another can arguably be seen as having developed in conjunction with or in direct response to the frameworks of ethics and moral tradition that existed and still exist within the European context. So when we look, for instance, at theoretical frameworks, the concepts of both realism and liberalism, as well as, frankly, the concepts of constructivism, socialism, and even communism, all can be found to originate within the historical evolution of what we term Western culture and civilization. The same thing can be said for democracy and capitalism. Finally, when we speak about the way in which groups like the United Nations or international organizations like the WTO, even Bellevue University and its ability to contact students around the world, these organizational frameworks, because of their dominance by Western society and thus Western frameworks of ethics and morals, they also have an impact on how these frameworks develop in other societies as well. For our purpose, it's important that you understand that, for better or for worse, these are the frameworks we need to begin engaging and understanding before we can begin then analyzing ethical frameworks for decision making. As I discussed for the previous slide, Western traditions and ethics tend to play a dominant role in our understanding of global traditions. When it comes to theoretical frameworks that we use to analyze ethics, morals, and ultimately decision-making, there is no denying the dominance of realism. As I hope becomes clear from the readings, realism in many ways harkens all the way back to what we can see as the evolution of classical European Western civilization. The core of realist theory can be traced all the way back to Greek philosophers such as Plato, Socrates, and frankly, Greek leaders and rulers such as Caesar. It's their understanding of the role of the state and power in politics that in turn began to set the foundation for understanding ethical frameworks. When you understand power as a dominant mechanism for international politics, it really colors your understanding of ethics. Whether it's the use of power, the rationale behind that use, or what you're targeting for that use, the idea of ethics is going to be conditioned by why you're using the power in the first place. In other words, the interests that you're seeking to promote or protect. For the realist, there is only one interest, survival. As a result, the ethics associated with the use of power for the realist are really associated with whether or not you can justify defense or the promotion of individual freedom as your reason for what you're doing. As long as, from the classical realist sense, you can say that you're promoting your security, then the use of power in one way or another can often be described as being ethical. The level of analysis quandary, really revolves around the individual versus the group, which I've already alluded to in one of the previous slides, as well as an understanding of the state as the primary actor according to realist theory. The state, as far as realists are concerned, are the primary holder of power when it comes to decision making at the highest level, i.e. the international system. As a result, the idea of examining ethics tends to revolve for the realist around an examination of the state, whether it's foreign policy or decision-making of leaders. Those are the ethical frameworks and thus the moral foundations when they apply that are most important to understanding ethics of what we'll call international politics. There is a fourth group that has been added to this quandary, if you will, and it's only recently developed. You could argue that with the evolution of the Cold War, especially in the 1970s and the 1980s, the rise of issues beyond the traditions of state power led to an understanding of the global community as an appropriate focus for understanding the ethics of decision making. A classic example here would be the rise of environmentalism starting in the mid-1970s. Environmentalism is a classic example of this fourth corner of the puzzle because it represents an ethical framework that exists beyond the individual, beyond ethnic, religious, or other normally defined groups. It exists beyond the state and even individual groups of states. The idea of environmental ethics encapsulates the idea of defining ethics and thus morals in ways different than the traditional frameworks. This is a way in which I can illustrate the importance of developing critical thinking. None of these analytical frameworks is in and of itself the truth. They all represent frameworks through which you can examine key questions and ideas. Is there a hierarchy of ethical importance when dealing with ethical dilemmas? You'll hear a lot of people say, stay true to yourself. I say it all the time. But how much should you stay true to yourself when that ethical goal is contrary to the needs or demands of your family, your business, your church, your country? I think a classic example or debate to throw out in this particular question would be the Edward Snowden affair. There are many who would argue he is a traitor and that he violated an oath he took as a member of the intelligence community. But there is a significant portion of the American, and even some within the government, who would argue that in fact he's a patriot, and he did what was needed to be done. He stood up for what was right. Should there be a hierarchy of ethical importance? Under what conditions, if any, do the ethical frameworks of others no longer matter for your decision making? I tell you now, this is something I think about on multiple levels all of the time. Raising a child really fundamentally altered my answer to this particular question, because the truth is, the moment I became responsible for the development of someone else's ethical framework, the responsibility created in me a desperate need to make sure that I walked the walk. And so I approach many of these discussions from that perspective. I guess one of the things that I need to say at this point in the discussion is simply that all of this involves bias. One way of defining bias is to consider the ethics and the morals with which you look at the world. The tragedy of the commons is a classic parable or case study examining this idea of the ethics of environmentalism. I offer it here as something that you can potentially look up your own online as a way in which you can see how even the best of intentions at one level of analysis can lead to ethical dilemmas at another level of analysis. If you have a common grazing area and the only intention for everybody in the town is to graze their cows, then no one could be said to be acting unethically relative to everyone else in the town. But the moment everyone wants to ultimately maximize their production, this is a classic economic case. You know, why not just have one cow? Why don't I have a couple of cows, and that way I can breed some for meat, and then I still have some for dairy? Now, the moment everyone starts doing that in the town, the quote-unquote tragedy of the commons is that you have environmental degradation, and the commons can no longer support everyone's needs. How do you ethically cap the ability of each individual towns member to use the commons? This is the foundation of the idea of government. How, if at all, has the war on terror affected our understandings of ethics and foreign policy? I think it has affected it in evolutionary ways. I think that what we understand about the ethics of foreign policy has changed dramatically, not just since the Cold War, but even since the post-Cold War period and prior to 9/11. The conduct of war in particular, in my mind, has changed in so much as the very nature of war itself has changed. There are no front lines as there used to be. There are no real theaters of war as much as I think many in the military establishment would love there to be so. Ultimately, one of the most important characteristics or aspects of the war on terror is the degree to which it creates a critical debate in the trade-off between security and individual liberty, especially in Western societies. Why this is important for our discussion of ethics is because I think it is crucial to understand that the discussion of ethics as they relate to conflict, and in particular, the conduct of war, the conduct of intelligence operations, the application of legal frameworks, these debates are not just taking place at the international or Middle Eastern level. They are taking place within individual states and even subgroups within those states. It is for this reason that you must come away from the week one readings having a clear understanding of what ethics are and how they are applied to international relations and intelligence analysis. The goal of the readings for this week is for students to develop a sound understanding of what a theory is and how it is developed. Further, students are expected to develop a general understanding of the primary theories that currently exist in terms of understanding and analyzing international relations and security studies. A theory is defined as a set of assumptions that is used to understand reality. Whether they are implicit or explicit, everyone uses theories, whether he or she knows it or not. One of the goals of both this course and the program in general is for students to develop the ability to move beyond utilizing simple sets of assumptions to understand that they are in fact theoretical tools and frameworks within which they can then
look at other people's assumptions or look at other people's behavior in an ethical or even analytical way. One of the important things to consider is you cannot try to explain all of reality at one time. It's important that you try and break down things to a concise manner so you can then see the exact relationship between the various things you're trying to study. Whether it's something like the trade-off between security and liberty, or the idea of security versus a terrorist threat. The reality is that you need to be able to define those things very clearly in order to begin testing whether or not your arguments and assumptions about how to deal with them are appropriate and valid. One of the tools, one of the basic tools of analysis, is the variable. A variable is defined as something which can be seen as having measurable change. To put it another way, the difference between analytical and descriptive writing is whether or not you're trying to examine the causes and consequences of the change in something, or whether or not you're simply trying to describe as it is at the moment. With regards to understanding variables, it's important to understand that there are different types of variables. Put another way, there are different pieces of the puzzle that you put together within your research framework that help you identify the things you're most focused on trying to explain. In that regard, the dependent variable is the referent object of analysis, or the topic of research that you're seeking to explain change in. One way to remember the importance of the dependent variable is it's the thing that your research or analysis depends on. It's the thing you're trying most to explain or give a discussion of. In that regard, the independent variable is the phenomenon that you're arguing explains the change or variation in your dependent variable. So if your dependent variable, for instance, is how aggressive Assad is going to be in terms of combating the insurgency in Syria, then you have to then consider what are the various things that would cause him to be more or less aggressive. His behavior is the dependent variable, his aggressiveness. Even that needs to be defined, so something like chemical attacks would be an appropriate definition there. The independent variables need to be defined as well, whether it's the number of insurgent attacks or international support of what he perceives to be insurgent units. All of these things have to be considered as potential causes of his final behavior within the dependent variable. Another example below. The more money you offer someone, the more likely they are to compromise their ethics. In this statement, individual ethics is the dependent variable that I'm arguing varies according to the application of the independent variable, money. The key here is that you're trying to examine the relationship between the two variables with a specific focus on the importance of ethics as the outcome of your analysis. Most political research and analysis focuses on what are called causal relationships, or the myriad numbers of dependent and independent variables associated with any given topic of research. Whenever you're developing research within these program courses, you will constantly push for more specificity and more detail in your analysis. The primary need for this is driven by the goal of creating as concise and well-defined variables as possible. The more well-defined your variables are, the easier they are to measure in some way, and thus the easier it is for you to show direct relationships between them. In this table, I'm trying to show you the primary theories that are currently established as guiding most international relations and security studies research. Down the left-hand side, you'll see the two primary theories that are most often discussed, realism and liberalism. But I've also included what I would call the secondary or neo theories as they've developed in a more contemporary sense. Across the top, you will see a listing of categories that I think is most important for you to understand these theories in a comparative sense. The idea of the unit of analysis is an explanation of what the theory tends to focus on most as the primary actor or agent in its analysis. The level of analysis is a focus on one of three generally accepted levels: the individual, the group or national level, and the systemic level. It's about trying to argue where you think the primary causes of relationships or analytical outcomes comes from. The common variables is just an attempt to try and give you an understanding of where the variable clusters or the ideas tend to be within these individual theoretical schools. Relative to our discussion in this particular course, it's important to understand how each of the theories views morality. In the same way, the view of each theoretical school of human nature not only informs their view of reality or morality, but then their understanding of how and why different actors in their theoretical frameworks make the decisions that they do. Finally, in the last category, I'm trying to offer some sort of overview as to the various topical schools or primary areas of actual theory and hypothesis testing that you see develop within the schools themselves. So if we begin with realism, it's important to understand that in many ways it's one of the oldest traditions. Realism can be dated all the way back to the work of Thucydides and then up through more contemporary authors such as Clausewitz, Hans Morgenthau, and then Kenneth Waltz. The primary unit of analysis is the state. You have to understand that realism in many ways believes that everything comes down to what it sees as a system of anarchy. In a system of anarchy, there are no actors to enforce the rules, so that the only way that actors can maintain their own survival is by acquiring power. It is only through power that they can then seek survival and ultimately, as a realist would argue, a classical realist, domination over other potential rivals. So for this reason, realists and their theoretical frameworks and arguments and hypotheses tend to rest most likely at the level of analysis of the national or system level. At the national level, realists tend to look at things like foreign policy, security policy, and defense spending, lots of economic theory and hypotheses, things that tend to explain the power of a state. Realists also very much tend to discuss the system in so much as that's where the competition between states takes place. It is the anarchic system, again, the absence of an overarching authority, that means that it's the contest between states that most often leads to war. War, as the most destructive or impactful aspect of human society, also tends to be the most common variable or focus of research within the realist framework. Associated with that is an understanding of power as a central concept for then understanding ethics, war, and almost all other aspects of human nature. For the realist, power, and especially hard power, the ability to make material threats and carry through with them, really constitutes a primary understanding of ethical frameworks. What little incorporation of deep philosophical understanding of morality that there might be in realism tends only to revolve around the role that national leaders in their decision-making tends to have on the overall power and focus of states. The key for realists is that, for better or for worse, they see humans as generally selfish and evil. This isn't that they believe all are selfish and evil. What it is that they, from the realist perspective, because you're in an anarchic system, there only needs to be a couple of actors with bad intentions that then force everyone else to act self-interestedly. They must be selfish to preserve their survival, precisely because they never know exactly who is their friend and who is their enemy. Because of this, power becomes the central component of realism, and thus, from the realist perspective, when we talk about security, we talk about balance of power, or the comparative or relative power between states, and how those changes in relative power affect the potential for war. Neorealism is the more modern version, or you could say post-Cold War version, of realism. It has many of the similar assumptions or frameworks of classical realism. Where it differs is in the understanding of what the primary focus of states are. As I said before, the primary focus of states and realism in general is on the balance of power. For the neorealist, it's on the balance of threat. Put another way, the neorealist accepts that not every single source of power is also a source of threat. An example that's often put out there, for instance, is the special relationship between Great Britain and the United States. That's the sort of relationship that classical realism would argue probably should have been broken asunder at some point due to disparate interests or differing levels of power, to the point that the United States no longer needed the United Kingdom, or maybe the United Kingdom would have tried to balance against or pull away from the United States. That's the sort of example that led to the development of neorealism and the shift from a pure look at power to a more varied look at the concept of threats. Once you start looking at threats instead of power, you move from the idea of war and how to deal with it to the idea of deterrence and how to avoid it. And so this is a really important distinction and difference in your understanding of neorealism versus classical realism. Liberalism approaches this in an entirely different way. And it's important to understand that liberalism approaches this almost from the foundational difference between in their understandings of human nature. In so much as realism tends to believe that the majority of human beings are selfish and evil, liberals tend to believe that the majority of human beings are generally cooperative and good. To be clear, liberals still recognize the existence of anarchy. There is no overarching authority to force everyone to be good. It's not like liberals are idealist and believe that there should be no war or anything like that. They understand conflict. They just don't accept the inevitability of conflict in the same way that the realists do. And part of this has to do with a belief that there's more than just states that should be examined as the primary unit of analysis. And so liberals are willing to look at broader societies. They believe ethnic and religious groups are essential to understanding international politics. But they also move beyond that to argue that there are much broader issues that really constitute core foundations of international relations, and it's not just power. It's shared systems of governance and understanding. So for the liberal, things like human rights and democracy, a belief in a universal morality, these are core concepts of the liberal that really define it as fundamentally different from the core concepts of the realist. It is because of this that you will tend to see a much stronger focus on things like morality and ethics in liberal theory and literature relative to what you see within the realist literature and theory. A primary focus for liberals is the idea of interdependence. Interdependence is directly related to the concept of globalization. It's a pretty simple logic argument. The closer two units get, the less likely they will have conflict, because conflict will then have a greater disruption of both of them. So whether it's increased diplomacy or economic trade, interdependence through globalization is seen by liberalism as a key indicator that, in fact, realist understandings of the world don't necessarily hold sway. It's not just power versus power and just waiting for the next war. From the liberal perspective, everything from the United Nations to the existence of the UN to the growing idea of a global environmental consciousness is proof that there is a much deeper understanding of both international relations and human morality and nature in particular that's not captured by realists. As we move to liberal institutionalism and liberal internationalism, we see the evolution or advancement of liberalism, classical liberalism, in the same way that neorealism represents the evolution of classical realism. If classical liberalism is focused on general ways of developing greater cooperation between societies, liberal institutionalism is looking at specific mechanisms. More directly, it's focusing on the governance component of the classical liberals, to argue that IGOs and NGOs, the systemic development of things like international law and rules and guidelines for behavior, it's these things that actually force the behavior of states. So while they accept anarchy, again, none of these theories are arguing anything other than anarchy as the system. They're arguing, how do we understand this system? And that's where the differences come in. The liberal institutionalists say it's not just about interdependence and let globalization do its thing. You actually have to work to cultivate these IGOs, intergovernmental organizations, and NGOs, non-governmental organizations, as mechanisms through which we create rules and guidelines for behavior. They believe the classical liberals are right about the general human nature being cooperative and good, but they believe that this has to be nurtured and enforced through systems that, for instance, punish bad behavior, or allow the system as a whole or the community of states to work together to create greater good. So you'll see the focus in liberal institutionalist theory being on increased structures of communication and cooperation as the method through which to decrease conflict. Liberal internationalism again builds off the classical liberal perspective. Their focus again is on the idea of building on what they believe to be the generally cooperative and good nature of human beings. The focus here, however, is not as much on the systemic and institutional frameworks that help build that cooperation. Liberal internationalists tend to have a more holistic understanding of how these rules develop, with a specific focus on the idea of norms, the idea of shared understandings, specifically democracy. Liberal internationalism focuses on governance, political systems, social development, and economic development as the foundations of a stronger and less conflict-ridden society. If we can all, for instance, experience economic growth and development, and we can decrease inequality, then from the liberal internationalist perspective, we have by definition decreased the room for conflict with the international system. Again, all three liberalisms rest under this idea of globalization and interdependence. It is important to understand that just as the realists believe that war because of power differentials unavoidable, the liberal theoretical frameworks believe that cooperation under globalization and interdependence is also inevitable. So there are two competing threads here. And while I think there's some overlap sometimes between realism and liberalism, my argument is you need both to actually explain international politics. The final school of thought, if you will, is probably the most recent in development. Constructivism, in many ways, can be considered the school of thought that developed as a result of the collapse of the socialist and communist theory that dominated the Cold War era, especially in Eastern Europe. Constructivism is looking at a variety of different explanations for conflict and the way in which all of these different secondary components that both liberalism and realism are examining. What they're focused on, however, is not the variables themselves, building international law, creating greater deterrence frameworks, building state power. What they tend to focus on most are the meanings associated with these concepts, behaviors, and theoretical frameworks. More importantly, they tend to argue that it's the ability to create meanings, especially on the part of elites, that constitutes the real framework of analysis. If you don't understand the intentions behind the meanings, then you'll never quite understand the realities of the various theoretical frameworks you're trying to develop. So let's say, for instance, we go back to the analogy on the previous slide and discuss ethics and money. A constructivist, rather than trying to engage that hypothesis from an analytical perspective, would step back and ask a question like, is it a woman or a man? That's going to make a big difference, and I can't answer that without that knowledge. They might ask a question as to why do we even use money as a definition or as a direct contrast to ethics in the first place. In other words, they're going to question the subjective and contextual meanings of the concepts and theories being engaged. This makes them, in my opinion, a very important component of analysis. I think in many ways you can see constructivism come out in contrarian thinking, alternative hypothesis testing, alternative historical analysis, anything that involves looking at non-factual or meaning-driven analysis is when you start getting into constructivist frameworks. The problem from an analytical perspective and why constructivism is most often thought of as an alternative to either realism or liberalism is in the end when all you do is question meanings it's inherently difficult, if not impossible, to create definable and measurable variables. As a result, the very notion of an independent and dependent variable becomes an issue of discussion for constructivists. And you will find more often than not, the realists and liberals have already picked up their notebooks and moved on to the next discussion. I want to take a moment and quickly go over two theoretical or conceptual ideas that are not only brought up in this week's readings, but may probably show up in other readings as well. The first concept is that of ontology. Ontology is an understanding of what reality is. Within the Fleming article this week, it is referred to as metaphysics. For examples of ontology or ontological frameworks, I ask you to consider the idea of religion versus science, as I believe these are the two most commonly used ontological frameworks that people would be familiar with. What is important to understand is that each cognitive framework contains a distinct set of assumptions that automatically orders reality a certain way for its user. It can be thought of as a pair of colored glasses through which the user or wearer views reality. Neither is right or wrong. The key is to understand, before you do analysis, which framework or decision-making framework, to be more specific, something is being considered within. Epistemology is how we judge truth. It is the method by which we verify knowledge or experience within our ontological frameworks. For religion, the seeking of truth rests on prayer and spiritual consultation. For science, the idea of truth is grounded in the scientific method. Both are a framework for confirmation grounded in the original ontological assumptions. To put it another way, we all have bias. It is impossible as an analyst to get away from the idea of bias in our research, bias in our source selection, bias in how we read documents. We see this every day if any of you are watching the news. Bias is probably at the core of just about every complaint you see, from complaints against the government, complaints in favor of the government, for and against the media, support or no support for the current president, the president-elect, or any number of the topics. Bias is simply our experiences and our frameworks of understanding reality that then cause us to judge the truth or righteousness of certain things certain ways. It is vital that you understand these concepts, especially in relation to the previous ones of ethics and morals, because all of these things come together as analytical tools that you can then begin applying to problems, whether they're ethical dilemmas or security threats. It's important to understand that there are certain concepts, variables, and tools that do and do not apply to certain problems. In concluding our discussion of the week two materials, we want to look at a few questions regarding human nature, as well as some of the broader or more philosophical aspects of the discussion that may impact the development of our analytical skill sets. The first question we look at is perhaps the oldest from a philosophical and political standpoint anyway, and that is whether or not human nature is generally good or evil. I say it in this manner because as analysts, I think it's vital that we continue to avoid developing absolute understandings of variables. And again, the good versus evil dynamic, human nature is the variable. If we're defining it, then we're defining it according to what we believe to be good or evil behavior or good or evil intent. But again, it's a variable. It can be measured and it can then be explained or tested or even predicted as long as we've created basic frameworks through which we're trying to understand or create those predictions. I would argue that one of the parts of the discussion that I'm really asking to engage here is the idea of balance. I'm hoping that one of the things that came across, for instance, in your examinations of the socio-religious heritages of ethical frameworks was the fundamental differences in the frameworks and how they viewed good and evil. I would argue, for instance, that one of the general differences between Western and non-Western understandings of human nature is the general idea of a pure choice between good and evil versus the non-Western tendency to look at a balance in human nature, understanding that all human beings tend to have the capacity for both. While I think this obviously plays out in differences between Western and Eastern cultures, I think it's also important to see that this difference plays out within the various theoretical frameworks and schools as well. I definitely would argue that there's a good versus evil component to the liberal versus realist perspectives of international theoretical debate. But I do have to say that I think the constructivist perspectives bring in the idea of potential causes of even discussing good versus evil, or how we're defining the variable itself. What does the scale include? And once we start getting deeper into the discussions of meaning, I think it opens up the door for some of these non-Western ideas when we discuss the idea of balance within human nature, and then the idea of balance within assuming how good and evil affect decision-making and thus ethics, or ethics and thus decision-making. The nature versus nurture debate is another crucial concept that goes with human nature and then, by definition, the concept of ethics. What aspects of human nature are inborn versus learned? I think a lot of us can kind of come up with things that we consider within people to just be maybe the way they are. I know there's a lot of stuff about myself at 47 years old. I'm just kind of the way I'm going to be. At the same time, I have to also, as an educator, recognize that by definition, I live my life under the belief that certain behaviors can be learned. So if they can be learned, can they be unlearned? And if ethics are something that are taught, does that mean they can be learned and unlearned as well? Can you rehabilitate a terrorist? Or are there certain aspects of human nature? Are there certain behaviors? Is it a behavior that can be rehabilitated but not a thought process? These are the sorts of questions I want you to consider when you think about the nature versus nurture debate within the broader ethical and moral considerations of analytical and theoretical research. How do the dominant IR theory paradigms reflect characteristics of human nature? Is realism a masculinized theory of international politics? And if so, to what degree does this explain its dominance within IR studies, foreign policy, decision-making, ethics? You know, there are a couple of stories that I could probably give you guys from my graduate school experiences that would help explain this from not just a gender perspective, but from a race perspective as well. But I think the one that hits home is I went to a school in New York for some of my undergraduate work, SUNY New Paltz. SUNY New Paltz is known for being in a very liberal school, had a very active feminist community. And so I often found myself sitting in political theory courses, and it would be me and maybe four or five other guys and 15 really angry women. And so one of the arguments that often came up was the masculinization of international politics and the degree to which all of this, the only reason that realism and power is dominant is because that's the language of masculinity. Here's the thing. I can't disagree with them. But there are all sorts of outtakes and additional questions that you have to begin to ask. So for instance, are there fundamentally different characteristics of femininity that you would then argue are going to change the nature of international politics? If there are, why haven't they manifested? So these are sorts of questions that I always tend to ask, or at least the constructivist part of me would. As you can probably guess, I wasn't always the most popular person in the class. That said, in my mind, the value of constructivism is that it forces to ask the deeper questions. It's not just a question of realism or liberalism. I think the question of why realism or why liberalism is just as valid. And when we talk about, for instance, the need to incorporate more women into the U.S. military, and then we suddenly ask ourselves, well, does that mean women should also be allowed to fight on frontline units? These are the sorts of questions that are actually practical manifestations of these highly theoretical and philosophical questions that I'm asking you to engage for this week's readings. This is not just an academic exercise. You have to understand that if all of the language of a military manual is written in masculinized language, it's going to create a certain environment or dynamic for women. And if you want the women to engage in the same systems and ethical frameworks as the men, then at some point we need to begin to recognize whether or not the very language itself creates different meanings and thus different processes and understandings of the analytical frameworks we're trying to apply. Finally, if they exist, how do we identify and legislate on a universal level understandings of morality and ethics? This is perhaps the core question at the heart of liberalism as we discussed in international relations. At the most basic level, if you're going to promote human rights, do you do so with an understanding that there is a universal set of human rights that everyone should follow? If there is, how do you uncover it? How do you, for instance, accept the gender relationships that tend to exist within Muslim or predominantly Islamic societies as part of their fair representation of their religion, while still recognizing the gender rights and the gender initiatives and definitions contained in the Declaration of Human Rights, for instance? The idea of comparative versus universal human rights really in many ways runs to the idea of liberal versus realist theory. If the realists are right and it's all about power, and at the end of the day, it doesn't matter if you're a Muslim or a Christian or a man or a woman, when you're threatened, you have power, you defend yourself, then the truth of the matter is that really this whole idea of a universal understanding of human rights doesn't matter in the first place. If the liberals are right, then it really does matter. And that is something that needs to be promoted. But within the liberal dynamic, as you've seen, there's a split. Within the liberal dynamic, you have to understand that there's the universal versus the comparative. Does culture matter? Or is it just this promotion of international law and the standard, a basic minimum set of standards that everyone should follow? These are the questions that really guide our theories and our debates surrounding ethics, surrounding the role of morality, and ultimately how we utilize these things when we develop analytical and research frameworks. So the core focus of the week three readings is the just war tradition. I think many of you were, at least in part, a little confused by aspects of this, or maybe more confused exactly as to how this fit into some of the previous discussions or readings assigned in earlier weeks in the course. The key here is to think of the just war tradition as its own ontological view. It's almost like you take a religious ontology and shrink it down and apply it just to the conduct of war. And so you have to understand from the beginning, one of the strengths and or weaknesses, depending upon the theoretical perspective you're taking, is that there's a very strong Judeo-Christian foundation to the idea of the just war tradition or just war theory. It begins with Augustine, who was writing as a monk during the end of the Dark Age, well, not even the end, kind of the middle of the Dark Ages, if you will, a time in which warfare had become about as barbaric as it possibly could be. Augustine, for all intents and purposes, was trying to reconcile the idea of war with what he believed to be God's will on earth. The simple question, and a question that frankly has been asked since all of time and continues to be asked today, is how can all this suffering, how can all this war be taking place if there is a will of God that guides most things or the decisions, or ultimately what needed to be done is a way in which to reconcile the Judeo-Christian principles on righteousness and justness in the eyes of God with the conduct and the causes of war. St. Thomas Aquinas follows this up by making much more specific kind of treaties or principles, but again, he is very much responding to what he sees as the nature of war as it developed during the medieval ages. Again, this is a period of time in which war had become extremely barbaric and vicious. And for St. Thomas Aquinas in particular, what he was seeing was the individuals who were most often paying the price of war were in fact the innocents, the children and the women and the citizens of the cities and towns that were caught in the middle of these rampaging armies. For both of them, there was a need to rationalize both the initiation and the conduct of war in the light of the role of the church in European society. Now, you have to understand that between the age of Augustine and St. Thomas Aquinas, the church had become increasingly important as the moral structure for the majority of states and societies within the European system. What is important to understand in terms of applying just war tradition today is it was a decidedly European concept. In other words, the quote-unquote rules or theories of a just war were very different in, say, the Arab and Islamic cultures in the Middle East, or the Mughal Empire and cultures that developed in the Indian subcontinent. And it was definitely different than what developed as understandings of warfare in the Asian and Chinese Empire. So as much as these can be seen as rules of war, you have to understand that just saying these are the rules of war can at times be somewhat offensive to non-Europeans, or more specifically, those who have a non-Judeo-Christian background. So that in and of itself creates one of the roles or one of the foundations of debate that surround the idea of the just war tradition. Another aspect or foundation to the evolution of the just war tradition is the need to justify both the initiation conduct of war in regards to the evolution of divine monarch. It wasn't just the rise of the church and the Pope in particular as a source of power within the European society that led to this increasing need to justify war. It was definitely also being driven by the need for divine monarchs to be able to initiate war as necessary from a political sense. So what you see, for instance, is an increasing justification of war as a decision of the leader, who then is an extension of God. The divine ruler, and thus his or her divine will, is enough to justify the war. All of this tradition, at least the religious component, begins to erode to a degree due to three things. First is the rise of liberalism, as it's associated with the Enlightenment, the scientific revolution, and then to a degree, the rise of industrialization. A second impact on the decline of just war tradition as a really firm framework, if you will, is the decline of the church in general. When discussing the just war tradition, it is important to understand that there are two basic categories of principles that are incorporated within the broader theoretical framework of the just war tradition or just war theory. The first category is referred to as jus ad bellum, or the justice of war. This category focuses on the principles and conditions that should be met before you can consider a war or the start of a war to be just or righteous. Now, it's important to remind you that the concept of justice here is in a certain way, at least in its early form, being driven by, again, the Judeo-Christian framework of ethics and morals. The concept of just authority focuses on the idea that war can only be initiated by legitimate and competent political authorities. This principle is a direct recognition of the importance of states, and specifically state sovereignty, as the basis upon which the legitimacy of war should be founded. This was not necessarily one of the earlier principles established within the just war tradition by Augustine, but it was definitely a nod by St. Augustus to the rising importance of the feudal system, and in particular, the hierarchy of authority that was being developed within the European state system, what would become the European state system at the time. Just cause refers to the idea that war can only be pursued under the following conditions: to right a significant injustice or wrong, in defense of an unprovoked attack, or in defense of an innocent ally or victim. This principle came into play recently within debates and discussions of foreign policy when the George W. Bush administration incorporated or developed the idea of preemptive attack as part of the broader strategy in the War of Terror. While certain tactical and strategic rationale were offered for the policy development, the reality is that the concept of a preemptive attack itself does in fact run counter to the just cause principle of the just war tradition. Just intention. This principle relies on the idea that war can only be pursued in direct relation to the just cause it is associated with. all efforts should be made to limit destruction, suffering, and the pursuit of objectives beyond the original cause. This principle played out in a couple different ways that can be seen in contemporary cases and examples. From a general conceptual standpoint, you can think of the principle of just intention as being related to the concept of mission creep. Mission creep is a concept that developed within U.S. foreign policy to describe the tendency of the United States to begin adding objectives or expanding the breadth or the focus of an intervention or war once the war began. Perhaps the most classic or original example of this would be claims of mission creep that ultimately sunk the success of the intervention in Somalia in 1993. I believe it was 1993. Another more direct and immediate example of the idea of mission creep affecting just intention would be the changes and impacts of strategic decisions that were made during both of the interventions in Iraq. In the first one, they did everything they could to not do more than push Saddam Hussein out of Kuwait, and this was done precisely because they did not want to add additional objectives to the broader war against Iraq or the liberation of Kuwait. You again saw the idea of war objectives and mission creep with the second intervention or invasion of Iraq, as the complicated nature of the strategies and goals involved in the war really began to evolve as the war progressed. The concept or principle of last resort relies on the idea that it must be clear that going to war was done only after all other potential political and diplomatic solutions had been exhausted. It is an essential idea to the idea of just war that it is in fact the only option available. If the argument could be made that other options were foregone or ignored, then the very moral or ethical basis of the war itself will always be questioned. The last category is in fact two principles kind of mashed together. The first one, proportionality, has an A designation to it because you need to know the concept of proportionality is also a principle within jus in bellos, or the justice in war, something that will be described on the next slide. With regards to the justice of war, proportionality refers to the idea that the war itself should represent more good than harm when it's actually developed or engaged. In other words, if there was a minor intervention or border skirmish between two states that was initiated, for instance, by a pariah state or a dictator, it's then not proportional to invade that state completely and to destroy its military, for instance. The idea of probability revolves around the principle that war should never be engaged unless there's at least a reasonably high probability of success. The idea of martyrdom as part of war is not a part of Western traditions or understandings of ethics of war. I think the designation or the impact of the probability issue is just one aspect of the inability of the West to really come to grips with the idea of suicide, terrorism, or even the kamikaze attacks of World War II as we see it beyond the righteous or the ethical way in which war should be fought. You shouldn't ultimately be, while you should be willing to give up your life to fight the war because the cause is just, the idea of giving your life as part of the cause is antithetical in many ways to what the Western tradition sees as the justice of war in general. The second category of the just war tradition is jus in bello, or justice in war. The first category was focused on establishing the ethical rationalization for the decision to go to war. The second category is designed to be a set of ethical principles that should guide the actual conduct of war itself. Here we start with the second proportionality principle, or proportionality B. This principle argues that the use of force in war should never exceed what is minimally necessary to achieve the desired goals. This principle really started to come into play when discussions of how force should be used during, again, the first Gulf War should be played out with regards to U.S. strategies during the conflict. Since the Vietnam War, and even going back to World War II, questions of how much is too much force have always plagued the U.S. military, predominantly because the U.S. military tends to have more options and more overall force available within individual conflicts. The result is that perhaps more than other militaries, the United States has always been very sensitive to the idea of proportionality in war. What is the amount of force that should be justified relative to the war aims that are being pursued? Perhaps the classic discussion of proportionality relative to the use of force in war revolved around the U.S. decision to drop nuclear bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki during World War II. While some and many have argued that in fact the dropping of the bombs was a significant reason why the war ended when it did, others have argued that it was also a clear demonstration of using much more force in a war than was necessary to achieve the desired goals. Discrimination, again marked A, as you see there is another form of the discrimination principle below. Discrimination A focuses on the idea that every effort should be made to discriminate between combatants and non-combatants. Non-combatants and the innocent should never be the target of direct attacks or the use of force. This is by far the single most important principle when we talk about how states and how the war on terror in general is engaging the concept of terrorism in particular. The reason why this is so important is because the very nature of terrorists revolves around the idea of embedding themselves within the non-combatant populations that they're targeting. The arguments from states is that through the use of terrorist tactics such as blending in with the population, they are establishing a non-application of this discrimination principle. Thus, the rules don't apply. My own perspectives, I feel like this is one of those situations where it is incumbent upon the states to continue enforcing the principle, not for the sake of their wars against the terrorists, but actually for the wars against each other, because now, once the precedent is set that this discrimination principle is highly malleable or contextually driven, I think the argument can now begin to be made in traditional state war that it no longer applies in certain instances. Special forces, for instance, that might not have insignia on their uniforms might be argued by one side or another to not be clearly discriminated combatants and therefore no longer subject to discrimination A principle. The third principle, one that really came forward in the World War period, is the development of the idea of humane treatment of POWs. As a principle of the justice in war, every effort should be made to treat POWs and the victims of war with dignity and respect. This includes everything to humane treatment in being held as a prisoner, to giving aid and comfort to the injured, doing everything within your power to not summarily execute, for instance, which was a policy, longstanding policy of many militaries when it came, for instance, to catching snipers or special forces units operating behind enemy lines. These individuals were often treated as somehow unprincipled or unethical members of the military machine, and thus again they were not being accorded the same rights and respect that traditional POWs or captured soldiers were being afforded. The last principle is discrimination. Again, I refer to this as discrimination B. In this principle, every effort should be made to discriminate against the methods of war that cause unnecessary destruction or suffering. Examples here would be landmines designed to injure rather than kill, WMDs, torture, any sort of tactic within the conduct of war that could be considered as being aimed more towards creating suffering than actual death. It's an interesting kind of ethical dilemma. Basically, what you're saying is if you're going to fight a war, make sure you're killing people and not just maiming them. An interesting application of this principle is it's one of those little stories of history, but basically The original design of the M16 included what was called a flechette round. It was a round that was designed to break into pieces once it left the barrel, with the goal of creating a higher capacity to catch more targets, to hit more targets with a single shell, because it was almost like a shotgun effect. The downside of this is that flechette rounds rarely killed, but they were increasingly seen as specifically designed to create suffering and to create maiming injuries. And so ultimately the US military moved away from the flechette round as the original round for the M16, precisely because they felt that it violated this principle of the just war tradition. So obviously the readings for week four were a little bit lighter, and hopefully they were intended to be somewhat overview-ish in terms of bringing together the various ideas and issues that were discussed in the first 3 weeks of readings. I also did not want to have a ton of readings for the fourth week, precisely because the goal again was for you to begin preparing for the component test at the end of the period. What I do want you to understand from the readings for this week is that there are enormous level of different trends, historical evolutions, and various inputs, variables, and considerations that go into the idea of the rules and laws of war. You need to understand, for instance, that the concept of itself of the rules of war goes all the way back to classical warfare and can be seen in some ways within the Crusades. Anyone that has ever had the opportunity to study the Crusades will quickly realize that the barbarity of the Dark and Middle Ages of warfare very much find their roots in the days of the Crusades. It was extremely common, for instance, to have either side that would win a battle then go into the city and kill every man, woman, and child that was still alive. The idea of taking Christian or Muslim prisoners of war was virtually unheard of unless the individual was a high-ranking knight or similar member of one of the other side's royal families. This idea of barbarity of war continued into medieval warfare, and again, in the interests of understanding why the laws and traditions of what we know today to be the rules of war developed, you can almost see in the 30 Years' War the evolution of barbarity. Every intention at the beginning of the 30 Years' War was to have it be driven by religious goals. Specifically, the wars between those who supported the development of the Protestant faith and the Protestant religious ethos, and those who were still beholden to the traditional church-driven Catholic ethos, found themselves at war across France and into the German principalities. And while the wars initially could be considered, somewhat principled, by the second and third stages of the 30 Years' War, it really became wars of annihilation. In many ways, they reverted back to the tactics that were being used by the Crusades, and the idea that if you truly want to end the war, you have to annihilate anyone who has the capacity to continue the war on the other side. This again meant burning entire villages to the ground, killing and raping and pillaging men, women, and children who really might not have had anything to do with the conflict itself. And ultimately, at the end of the 30 Years' War, one of the things that leads to the Treaty of Westphalia and the development of the modern state system is a need to create broader rules for the conduct of states, not just the conduct of war, but the conduct of diplomacy, and ultimately the relationships between states that hopefully would begin to mitigate the worst aspects of war itself. In terms of how these traditions and laws evolved into the modern era, you really have to look at the impact first of the American Civil War and the Napoleonic War. While you still had some of the really rudimentary components of the laws of war in place that existed from the classical and medieval periods, what you did have during the Napoleonic era was a development of the capacity of the modern state to conduct modern wars. This would lead to the concept of the total war during the World War period. But the evolution of the modern state ability to conduct war during the Napoleonic Wars initially led to two key developments. an exponential growth in the size of armies associated with war itself, and an increasing importance of the role of technology within war. Previous to the Napoleonic period, technology within war tended to be somewhat static. Whatever technologies existed when the war began tended to be the technologies of the war. Once you began studying the American Civil War period and Napoleonic Wars, you start to see that the war itself becomes an engine for technological advancement. When combined with the fact that we're now putting hundreds of thousands of troops in the field rather than tens of thousands, the capacity for death really grew at a rate much faster than any sort of legal or ethical framework was able to really take into account. So, for instance, you have to understand the impact of Antietam on the American culture as an illustration of what modern war can do to a society. People simply had never seen 20,000 dead bodies on a battlefield before. And so it was these sort of pictures, that and the idea of Napoleon, for instance, losing upwards of 700,000 troops in his march to Moscow. These are the sorts of things that really led people, societies in general, to begin considering developing what we now understand to be the laws of war. The second stage or development of modern understandings of wars and their traditions and ethics really is founded in the idea of industrialization and the development of, or the advent of, total war. The World War period, World War I followed by World War II, really encapsulate the moment at which the laws and rules of war needed to be made explicit. The level of suffering and destruction that was visited on the international system as a whole by both the World Wars was beyond anything, again, that had ever been seen before. World War I in particular plays a significant role in the development of the laws of war because, basically, it was initially a period in which anything goes. Any sort of tactic, any sort of strategy that can be developed by either the Allies or the Triple Entente during the World War I period was fair game. And obviously the most well-known and publicized of these tactics was the use of chemical weapons. It was not a mistake or coincidence that significant rules of war encapsulated in the Geneva Conventions was developed as a result of World War I. And I think relative to the concept of the laws of war that we know today, we can see World War I as being the foundation of the modern understanding of the rules of war. Following the World Wars, the invention of nuclear weapons represented the next significant step in the evolution of debates regarding the ethics, morals, and laws of war. The reason that nuclear weapons represent such an important stage in their development is because they represent in and of themselves an exponential increase in the amount of potential destructiveness associated with war. The very existence of nuclear weapons created ethical questions and dilemmas with regards to how states interact with each other during both war and peace that continue to influence discussions of deterrence, irregular warfare, and other specific strategies and tactics of states to this day. An additional aspect of the ethical dilemmas and debates that developed following the World War and into the Cold War period was the evolution of the concept of the superpower. Sparing a lot of the large detailed discussions, the general debate revolved around the idea of whether or not an additional set of rules were developing for the most advanced states in the system. Whether the discussions revolved around economic and international trade issues, the environment, or war itself, the idea of the superpower or the developed versus the developing world really created an additional layer of ethical discussions and debates that continue to incorporate themselves into specific analyses and research regarding security and foreign policy studies. An aspect of this that must be important to understand into the contemporary era is the degree to which the evolution of warfare, especially in regards to irregular warfare during the Cold War, set the stage for contemporary discussions and ethical frameworks examining the war on terror. Specifically, the increased use of revolution, irregular warfare, and terrorism during the Cold War really created an additional layer of specific discussions and debates, especially with regards to how the just war tradition would play a role in the development of the laws of war. Issues such as proportionality and the level of force used by states against non-state actors or their own population, issues regarding identification of terrorists as combatants, and ultimately the ethics of certain tactics used during the war on terror itself, have continued to demonstrate, in my opinion at least, the importance of understanding the framework of the war of the just war tradition as an analytical tool for understanding the ethical aspects of war today. I think a lot of these discussions continue to be valuable in the context of the future of war as well. When you get to the cyber realm in particular, I think many of the ethical issues that have developed relative to state relations and state-level war are going to have to be reconsidered, and in fact, they probably already are being so. I think it's fair to think of the world of cyber as lying above or beyond the existing level of state interactions and relationships. So the key to cyber, in my perspective, is the degree to which it does not really take into account existing understandings of sovereignty or state relations as the driving mechanism behind social relations. As a result, things like both domestic and international law seem to be relatively ineffective in terms of governing the relations and the behaviors within the cyber realm. Because the laws are not as applicable, I suppose an argument can be made that the ethical frameworks that have developed over the last 200 to 300 years that guide state behavior, especially with regard to conflict, may need to be re-examined or thrown out altogether when we consider the current and potential characteristics of cyber conflict. Things, for instance, like attribution or proportionality really have to be reconfigured when we're talking about cyber and what are essentially virtual threats and attacks. What, for instance, would be the proportional response on the part of the United States should it be discovered that the Russian state, without a doubt, was behind Russian hacking, or at least the recent arguments and evidence pointing to Russian hacking in the U.S. election? What would be the proportionate response, not just from a broader should we respond level, but from a deeper tactical or strategic level? What actually would we seek to attack? What would we seek to accomplish? These are the questions that I think, I hope that you come out of these first 4 weeks being able to engage and not just think about in the CNN media newsy kind of perspective. I'm hoping that you understand the need to develop clear analytical frameworks, frameworks that understand and incorporate established theoretical perspectives, and which utilize highly developed and defined variables to then create analytical explanations or predictions. The primary goal of the program as a whole is to have students develop their critical thinking. When you hear the term think outside the box, it often begins with what is called contrarian thinking, or argumentative positions taken for no other reason but to suggest the plausibility of alternative definitions and explanations. In this sense, contrarian thinking often becomes the foundation of the comparative method or comparative focus in international politics. It's simply taking the position, A might be true, but what if we consider B to be true instead? When we start with contrarian thinking, or we start to develop our comparative thinking in terms of critical analysis, we ask questions such as, if there is no conceptualization of universal morals and ethics, how does that impact our understanding of universal set of laws and wars? Simply put, if we understand morals and ethics to be culturally or contextually driven, how then do we go about creating international law or international systems designed to enforce that law? This leads to questions such as, in what ways can it be argued that the existing laws of war and the just war tradition in general is biased against non-Western or non-Judeo-Christian societies and states? How is that bias being defined? And are there non-Western ontologies of war that are appropriate to consider? This last question often makes me think about the Western fascination with Sun Tzu as a philosopher of war from the Chinese civilization. While we like to make quotes from his manual or discuss his philosophies in sort of an obtuse manner, the reality is that the writings of Sun Tzu represent a much deeper ontology or philosophy of how the Eastern civilizations engaged in war itself. If we believe in any way that the value of Sun Tzu's writings are that they do in fact illustrate a different perspective of war, then we by definition need to begin to question the foundations of the just war tradition as the framework, if you will, of international law today, especially international law as it governs conflict. How should insurgency, revolution, and similar forms of irregular warfare be viewed from an ethical standpoint? To what degree are the laws of war prejudiced in favor of the nation state? I suppose I should add at the end of this, should the laws of war be prejudiced in favor of the nation state? I should say, in all honesty, that I tend to be biased towards the nation state. I have a preference for stability driven by the rule of law, and I believe that ultimately it's the nation state and its monopoly on the use of force, as well as regulation of that force, that constitutes the stability of society. As much as I understand that not every nation state is just or righteous, I'm not sure that we can automatically include the concepts of insurgency and revolution as being potential justifications for righteousness of war. We can't, for instance, create laws that protect insurgency and revolution on the same level as we intend to protect the nation state. But how does that in turn allow us to then question the ethical behavior of nation states when they, for instance, violate the rights of their own citizens, commit violent acts against their own citizens or the citizens of other nation states? These are some of the most significant questions, I would argue, that are driving the ethical foundations of debates of international politics today. When you add specific aspects of the just war tradition, like proportionality, you have to begin to at least debate the idea of drone warfare as unproportional, disproportionate to what we're receiving as the use of force against our state. A significant question in debate is the degree to which we have incorporated or developed the idea of preemptive use of force as being justified within the context of conflict. There are many who would argue that the just war tradition explicitly argues that preemptive acts of violence are never justified. They must only be in relation to defending already exhibited uses of force against innocents or in other ways unjust uses of force. Finally, what should the ethical framework be for determining specific principles of the just war tradition within cases of conflict and war? I think the primary complaint that the developed world or that the non-Western world has against the just war tradition and the associated international laws and rules of war is that they're not applied universally or consistently to conflict. I think part of the debate revolves around whether or not there is a cultural disconnect between what some of the laws and ethical frameworks are. But I definitely think the deeper debate is the belief that the West tends not to have the laws of war applied to them at the same level or in the same ways as the non-Western states have them applied. Whether we're talking about legacies of imperialism or colonialism, or even legacies of socialist theory as they exist in some of the more underdeveloped regions of the world, the reality is that ethical debates surrounding war, its laws, and the traditions of how it's fought, avoided, and concluded continue to be critical debates for both security and foreign policy studies today.